I think most of us know the story of Cinderella, but many of us won't know the story of the Cinder Lad called Assipattle. This snippet of folklore will put that to rights. This is a little tale from Orkney, a stunningly beautiful collection of islands in the northeast of Scotland, a place of wilderness, Neolithic places, tombs and villages, where Vikings settled and left their artwork and their stories carved into the rocks. And it is this story that was most certainly another of their gifts to the culture of Orkney. Once there was a boy, a seventh son, a special number indeed. He lived at his family farm at a place called Leagarth. The farm sat nestled safely in the valley there. His father was a respected man in the community and a member of the Thing, the meeting of the Scandinavian Parliament of his day. Assipattle was a dreamer at heart and prone to be a rather lazy boy, lost often in a world of his own, and so rather a disappointment to his respected father and his brothers. As the seventh child, he was the one who had all the hand-me-down clothes, tattered and patched, and was the one given all the menial jobs around the farm that the others could not be bothered to do. His was the tough, boring work, and he was the child that the others teased mercilessly. It was his sister who showed him caring and affection for young Assipattle. In the evenings he would sprawl by the fire, his hands and feet in the ashes of the hearth, in the cinders, raking them around, dirty and scruffy, creating fabulous tales of himself. In his own imagination he was always the hero, and always victorious in all his quests, of course. Only his sister in all the household loved these stories and agreed. One day, Assipattle would do great good. The sad day came when Assipattle's loving sister had to leave to take up her work in service as a maid for the daughter of the king. The princess was called Gem de Lovely, and she was the king's one and only child. After a short time that his sister had been gone, a great calamity came to the land. A time of fear and worry had arrived, in the shape of an evil, enormous, vile serpent, the master Stoor Wyrm. The wicked beast terrorized all the lands of the king, destroying the villages. The animals were butchered, the fear of the worm ever present in the minds and the lives of the people. In desperation, the king turned to his adviser for help, a sorcerer, a cunning man, a wizard. The sorcerer told the king that the answer was to feed the deadly worm themselves, but the food must always be the same, given as an offering each Saturday. 7 virgin girls and ladies of the land. The king commanded this to be done, and for a time, only a short time mind you, this worked. But naturally the people grew angry. Their daughters were being sacrificed for heaven's sake. 7 innocent lives each Saturday lost to the Maester Stoor Wyrm. And then 7 more and 7 more. When would it end? The people of the land demanded the king find another way, and once again the king sought advice from his sorcerer. He was told that the only way to rid the land of this dreadful beast was to make the ultimate sacrifice himself. He must feed the Stoor Wyrm his only child, his beautiful daughter Gem de Lovely. However, there was some time before the coming Saturday to find someone who could kill the monster. Shame he didn't think of this before sacrificing many young girls. One of the courtiers warned the king that if the death of the princess was not enough though, and the worm did not leave, the next meal giving to the monster would be the damned sorcerer himself, and the rest of the court agreed. The king gathered his messengers to him. He told them to spread the word far and wide that if some brave soul would come forwards to slay the evil worm and free the land, on the death of the worm, he would give them not only his kingdom, but his magical sword that had once been that owned by Odin, Sikkasnapper, and last but not least, the hand of the princess in marriage. Everyone loved the princess, except her wicked stepmother, so surely some brave people would come forward to help. Eventually, one of the king's messengers arrived at the farm of Assipattle and his family. They were told of the plea of the king and the rich rewards that would come to the killer of the deadly beast. Assipattle, dirty from the cinders, drew himself up to all of his height. He would go forth, he announced. He would go forth and kill the worm. This, his brothers and father fell about laughing. His mother did too, as if. Assipattle in his tatters, covered in cinders, the hero of the hour. What a ridiculous thing. In the meantime, many a would-be hero had travelled to the lair of the deadly worm, and at just one sight of the enormous beast had fled. Heroic, but not that heroic. It was now the night before the sacrifice of the Princess Gem de Lovely. The king sat in his chamber distraught. He had an idea. He called for his servants. They were to get ready a boat and polish his magical sword, Sikkasnapper. He would kill the worm himself or die trying at least. Back at Leagarth, at the farm, Assipattle listened quietly as his family made plans to take a trip to watch the sacrifice of the princess. His parents would ride together on his father's horse Tikong, renowned far and wide as one of the fastest and sure-footed of all horses. The brothers would stay at the farm, taking care of all that needed doing there. Assipattle also, useless boy as he was. Still quietly listening from the shadows, Assipattle heard his parents discussing the curious way that was needed to get the noble horse Tikong to gallop as fast as he could. Nobody even considered that the useless boy was listening. Now, knowing Tikong's secret, he prepared what he needed. Taking something from his father's pocket, he would wait until all the household was asleep and put his very own plan into action. Once the household was quiet and still, Assipattle crept quiet as a fox out of the cottage and across the yard to the stable where Tikong was resting. Quiet as the mouse this time, he slipped the bridle over Tikong's head and once out of hearing jumped on Tikong's broad back. The horse bucked, knowing the stranger was on his back. Knowing the secret, though, Assipattle patted the horse's left shoulder to encourage him to be still. And the horse was. He patted the horse on the right shoulder, and at this, Tikong picked his ears up, raised his head, gathered his huge muscles in bunches and sprang forth, galloping across the land with all the speed of the whistling wind. Behind him, Assipattle could hear his father and brothers mounting the farm horses and giving chase, shouting and shouting, getting closer and closer as they gained on him. His father shouted at Tikong enchanted words and the horse stopped still. But now, Assipattle took the thing that he had taken from his father's pocket. It was the windpipe of a goose. He blew through it, as he had heard tell, and soon was moving so fast through the fields that it seemed he barely touched a blade of grass with his lightning hooves. Before he could even believe the speed of Tikong, Assipattle found that they were close by the seashore. The first early morning glints of the sun rays were just starting to peer over the horizon. Assipattle slowed Tikong down and jumped to the ground. He found a place nearby where he could leave the horse and looked for where he could find the next thing that he needed. He saw just that, a little cottage nearby with a grey spiral of smoke swirling from the blackened old chimney. Silently, He crept into the cottage. An old woman lay sleeping in a cot by the hearth. Assipattle held his breath, so not even the sound of this would wake the sleeping lady. He picked up a shovel that stood by the fireplace and reached into the fire with it, quietly lifting one of the hot, smouldering peat turves and carrying it to an iron pot. He placed the smouldering peat gently inside. Now he saw what he needed next, the boat of the king. The soldier who was on guard in the boat was so cold that he was near blue with it. Assipattle sauntered over to the shore and hailed to the guard. Come and get warm near his pot. He would light a fire and cook some food while keeping nice and warm. Assipattle started to dig a hole to build a fire. The soldier was ignoring him. Assipattle stopped. He stood. Gold! He shouted. Gold! The soldier jumped out of the boat and rushed to where Assipattle stood. Assipattle, meanwhile, was running in the opposite direction. He stole the boat and rowed away. Away to where the Stoor Wyrm lay sleeping. As he came closer and closer, the hideous giant sea serpent began to wake and opened its mouth wide as a cavern as it started to yawn in the early morning light. At the beast's huge in-breath, Assipattle, the boat, and the hot peat were carried straight into the worm's mouth, down and down its long sinuous throat, and down deep into its very stomach. Here the boat finally came to rest. Assipattle now lifted the burning peat out of the pot, and using the strange light of the monster's stomach, he searched around. He found what he was looking for and shoved the burning hot peat into the monster's liver. He watched as the peat began to get hotter and hotter, becoming smoulders, becoming fire, then becoming a roaring blaze, a blaze that could become as fierce as a furnace. The heat was intense. Assipattle was done. He ran quickly back to the boat and hunched down small as small could be. And now the worm began to squirm, pain beginning to fill its body. It writhed with the pain that was growing moment by moment in its liver. Second by second, the pain was fiercer and fiercer. Finally, the worm retched, and it was dreadful. Assipattle, safe in the small boat, flew straight out of the monster's mouth. On the seashore, the crowds were already gathering to watch the Princess Gem de Lovely be sacrificed to the worm. None of them had any clue of what had been happening at all. And yet from the skies came a boat. A boat spat out by the enormous beast. It landed right amongst them on the beach. And from that boat climbed a quite stunned and very soaked Assipattle. Back out at the worm's lair, the beast was now writhing in agony. Its screams filled the air. The smoke coming from its burning stomach filled the air too, streaming from its mouth and nostrils in thick black gouts of stinking foul clouds. As this continued, the smoke turned the skies grey, then black, and blacker still. At this, the people took to their heels and fled to the hills, climbing over each other to get away. Surely this was truly the end of the world. On the hillsides, high, high above, they stopped and turned to watch the death of the Stoor Wyrm. It still slashed and flashed wildly. The earth itself began to rumble at the thrashing of the great worm. Earthquakes rocked the land, and tidal waves followed. The people on the hill watched this in fright. Finally, after what seemed an age, the deadly worm began to die. And as it began to die, its huge teeth fell from its great mouth and fell into the sea. There they landed, and they stayed, and these became the islands of Orkney and Shetland and the Faroes. The beast's horribly long and once flickering tongue fell limp with a great splashing. And this is how the Baltic Sea was created here. At last, and not before time, the enormous Stoor Wyrm curled in its finality, writhing tighter and tighter into the tightest knot. It shuddered its last and settled, the broiling seas becoming stiller. The worm's body began to harden, harder and harder and harder, and eventually it became an island that today is known as Iceland. Now the thing was done. The beast was dead. The land was saved. Although new lands were there now to explore, all eyes turned to brave Assipattle, including those of the king of all the land. He handed Assipattle his magical sword, that once belonged to Odin. He placed the hand of the princess in that of Assipattle. They should be married. Assipattle and the princess climbed high onto the back of noble Titgong, and at the words of Assipattle, they galloped back to the king's castle. At the castle gates, Assipattle's beloved sister ran to greet them. Her brave brother, whom she had always loved and always had the greatest of faith in, and the princess, who had become a dear friend. Assipattle's sister had sad news for the young pair, news that would shock all of the court. He leaned his head to hear this news. It had been so that the king's wife, Gemda Lovely's wicked stepmother, had actually been the lover of the king's sorcerer. And it had been their plan to kill the princess, the only heir to the kingdom, and claim the throne for themselves. Assipattle's sister told him the evil pair had already fled that place. Assipattle set the fair princess to the ground with his sister where she was safe. He turned Titgong on the road. He spoke the secret words and patted Titgong's shoulder. Titgong took flight with hooves as fast as the lightning that flashes across the stormy sky. His shoes sparked along the stones. Soon he spied the couple on the road before him and he blew the windpipe of the goose. And now they were his. He raised Sikkasnapper high and brought the sword down with all of his might. And the sorcerer was dead on the road. The evil queen cowered in fright before Assipattle. He reached down and he dragged her to the back of Titgong, and once more the horse took off. Assipattle would leave the queen's fate to the justice of the court. They did sit and judge her, and the wicked woman spent all the rest of her days locked in a high tower, a cell at the top of the castle. As for Assipattle, the lad who was once covered in cinders, our brave Cinder Lad, the fool of the farm, the dreamer. Well, he did marry Princess Gemda Lovely. The feasting and revels, it is said, lasted a whole 9 weeks. And the king honoured his word too. Assipattle became the ruler of all the land, and he was a good ruler, no doubt. And of course they did all live happily ever after. And if they are not dead yet, they are yet alive still. I hope you enjoyed this little snippet of folklore from the Orkney Isles. I'll be back soon with another fascinating story or true tale, or one of my episodes of a longer theme. Meantime, keep well, dear friends. Brightest of blessings. And remember, don't play with the fairy folk, or you may end up in one of my folk tales yourself.